Welcome to Stepping on the Mat podcast, episode 009 with me, Aaron Martinez. Today's guest is an accomplished Iowa high school and college wrestler. In high school, he was a two-time state champion. He was also a cadet Greco-Roman national champion, a junior Greco-Roman All-American, and a two-time USA folkstyle national champion. As a college athlete, he was a two-time NJCAA All-American. He finished his career at Grandview, where he placed third at the 2012 NAIA National Championship and helped Grandview win their first national team championship. He now devotes his knowledge and experience and energy to helping wrestlers accomplish their own goals when stepping on and off the mat. The Moen Wrestling Academy, as I've seen for myself, is a hub for wrestlers that gather from all skill levels and talents who get led and tapped into a deeper transformational process of success, hard work, self-belief, and next level competition readiness. Ladies and gentlemen, my guest, TJ Moen.
Hey,
welcome,
you.
TJ.
Thank you.
That was a long introduction, man. You've done a lot in your time.
Yes, yes. It's been a process for sure. I remember, you know, first put my wrestling shoes on, and I remember the last time I took them off.
Yeah, it's interesting. The first time I came to watch you and your team, or you and your academy over at Simpson, one of the first signs I see to said embrace the process.
Yes.
So over a time from being an athlete, or you're still an athlete, but being a competitive athlete to being a coach, you put a lot of time. How many years totally have you been in wrestling?
Been wrestling since first grade. So, what year was that?
We need the mathematicians in the room now.
Yeah. Long time. I say over 20, 25 years. You know, I'm 34 years old right now. I started wrestling when I was 6 years old. And the reason why I started wrestling, my friend was wrestling. You know, he started wrestling in kindergarten, and I knew he was a wrestler. And, you know, I was kind of ornery as a youth. And my dad got me in wrestling the following year. And ever since then, it's taken off.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So, like, some people, like, when I talked about jiu-jitsu, I'm like, yeah, I've been doing it for 20 years. You know, not just the wrestling, but 20 years of just doing solid jiu-jitsu. And it's like, man, doctors don't even spend that much time, you know? Like,
right.
it's a devotion to something that is, like, maybe doesn't always have the highest payback,
right.
You know?
Right, right.
I want to, before we get into wrestling, I want to, you know, talk about something super important. I know it's important to you as your family. Maybe tell us a little bit about Morgan and you have three girls, right?
Yep, three young girls, beautiful girls.
Yeah, yes. Tell me about it.
Me and Morgan have been together since 2010. She's been by my side the whole time. I've been by her side the whole time. You know, there's times where, you know, financially we were not quite there. And we had to stick together and tough it out. And there's times where, you know, when times are hard, you know, having our first child, it's been a process. And I'm sure, you know, every married couple go through that, you know, that first initial phase of adulthood with kids. It's tough. You know, I was coaching college wrestling down in Campbellsville University. And at first, you know, she didn't come with me. We got engaged that spring, I believe, spring or summer. And I told her the news, hey, you know, I accepted a coaching position down in Kentucky.
Yeah,
and she's like, what?
Yeah.
So totally, totally surprised her on that one.
Yeah, it's interesting. We have a parallel here as well. You know, I can see where Morgan would have some, you know, resistance, like, man, you know, we're just getting engaged and you're going to Kentucky and now you're asking me to move. That's a big commitment to leave family and everything. I told you I lived in Kentucky as well, and I was in the same boat. Me and my wife were engaged at the time, and I was in Kentucky, and she had to make the big jump of leaving, you know, job and her security and family here in Iowa to come join me. So
and you know, going back to that financial part, you know, me and Morgan both had, you know, good jobs here in Des Moines. You know, working hard every day. You know, we bought our first house together in Des Moines. It was going good, right? And I took that position in Kentucky. You know, I knew the risk of going down there, and you know, financially wasn't going to make what I was going to make here in Des Moines. And I knew that, and, you know, took that risk, and I went down there, and everything was, you know, it wasn't a bad decision. You know, it was all a learning curve. I learned a lot when I was down there. Coach Frankie James, you know, he saw the potential I had And he kind of gave me the reins of, you know, leading his team for the 2 years I was down there. As soon as I got on campus, you know, I got my hands on a college wrestler, a Kentucky wrestler. You know, he's a runner-up in his senior year. And, you know, if you compare state to state with wrestling, you know, you don't think much of Kentucky.
Right.
You know, I'm not trying to dog on that state, but, like, you know, Iowa's a tough state, you know, Oklahoma's a tough state, Minnesota's a tough state, all the Midwest states are, you know, you got Pennsylvania, New Jersey, they're tough wrestling states. And I got my hands on this kid, and I'm just rolling around and just beating him up left and right. You know, like, he's a college wrestler, like, he should be, you know, if you want to be an All-American, you know, you got to be somewhat a contender, you know, with me and score points. You know, I bust my butt off this kid for the 2 years I was down there, and he ended up getting fourth at the NAI championships. And, you know, that's a change I made in that kid's life, because he never thought he could be an all-college All-American. He never thought that he could do it. You know, I changed his whole lifestyle, changed the way he thought, the way he wrestled. Everything, you know, I still stay in contact with all those kids, especially that one wrestler that got on the podium from Kentucky. We all stay in contact with each other. You know, you create a bond with these kids. You create, you know, if you change one thing for them like that, you know, that sticks with them, and they come back and say, "Hey, coach, you know, that one thing you told me about," like, "Yeah, well, thank you, you know, because it's changed my life." And that's the things I want to hear.
Yeah, that's like that unseen, like, passion and perseverance that you don't see the reward until you get to the end of it, or even years down the road, right? Like, Morgan's at home, like, "Hey, you're chasing this," but, like, she's got to be able to see that vision in you too, and trust that vision. Be like, "Hey, you know, he's pursuing something that he sees that's coming, you know, it's going to have some payoff in the future." You know, and I'm glad that you got that opportunity and she supported you during that. Yes. So when did you guys reconnect after moving down to Campbellsville, right?
Yep. So that first year I went down to Campbellsville. I went down there by myself. I was living with Coach James. I actually got kicked out of an apartment because I brought my cat with me.
So you're a cat guy?
Yeah, I'm a cat and dog guy. We got the cat first. And he was an ornery little cat too. Crazy cat. I probably won't get a cat ever again after him. So
my jiu-jitsu teacher, he lived in Kentucky as well. He grew up in Kentucky. He was a wrestler there.
Oh, nice.
And he had a cat named Ninja, and told me to, there was a UFC poster that I had to grab because we had a fighter that fought, and he was like, "Yeah, it's just in the back room. Go in there and grab it." I went into that room and I ran out as quick as, like, that cat, like, ran around the wall. So
yeah, that's how mine was. Yeah. I had a Bengal cat.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, he was ornery. He had spotted, like, a leopard on his belly, and he had the marble shape on top of his upper half. And yeah, his name was Ryu.
Ryu.
Off of Street Fighter.
Cool.
So yeah, he was ornery. So he came down with me, you know, we're in the living apartments, and I got kicked out right away. So, like, all right, whatever. Coach James, like, "Come with my house and, you know, we'll work it out." So that first year, yeah, living down there went good. Went back in the spring, got married. The week after we got married, we got the U-Haul, loaded it up, cleaned out our house, and moved down to Kentucky, me and Morgan, cat and dog. And got down there, had a house on the corner of the campus, and, you know, living down there for $400 a month is pretty cheap.
Yeah, yeah. House, especially these days.
Right. The house that we lived in was full of brown recluse spiders.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Yeah. Isn't it interesting? Like, you go to a different state and all of a sudden your pests become something much different than you were dealing with before.
Yes.
Florida, you get cockroaches, and,
right,
you know, down south, you start getting tarantulas and spiders. And
right. Yeah. 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 So we had to move out of there as soon as possible. She got bit on the cheek, and we had to rush her to the emergency room. And luckily, we caught it before it spread, because that would have been a bad deal.
Yeah, for sure.
Right there, and she wasn't having it. So then the trainer that was on campus, he was our wrestling trainer as well, and he was a pretty cool guy. I got to know him pretty well, and now he's doing a full time gig. You know, I think somewhere in Kansas, I believe. And by good guy, I missed him because he was a good trainer. We moved to his house that he's living in, and the AC hardly worked. I was like, oh, why can't we catch a break? You know, there's ants over in the kitchen.
You're fighting. You're like, is this it? Is this what it was supposed to be? Or should I stay back home?
Right. Exactly. Yeah. You know, and it worked out. You know, it was a good time with her being down there. You know, we bonded together, and she was working, you know, for a gym down there as well. And you know, we started getting, you know, like I go back to the financial part, you know, bill. It's getting a little bit tough, you know, cause we were also paying the bills back home, and, it was tough. And, we're talking about, you know, when are we gonna have our first child, all this fun stuff, that conversation.
Yeah.
That
yeah.
Every couple have. And, you know, we pulled the trigger and we decided to do what's best, you know, is come back home and be around her family, my family. And, and we moved back later that spring. And like I said, going down to Kentucky, you know, I'm glad I did, because Coach James, you know, gave me the opportunity to lead his team for the 2 years I was down there. Like, I did everything, run practice, workouts, weightlifting. And, you know, I was kind of like a head coach in the grand scheme of things, but I was doing it all.
Yeah,
I learned a lot, and you know, I brought that knowledge back home, and I still continue to learn every day, you know, from other wrestlers, from other coaches.
Because by this point, you've had so many coaches of your own,
right?
You know, you've picked in pieces of it that you've enjoyed from other coaches, you know,
right? Exactly. And later that summer, we have my first daughter, Hazel. She was born, and
where'd you get the name Hazel from?
Her great grandma.
Cool.
Yep. Her great grandma, and Hazel was very colic at birth. I remember holding her in a picture one time. Like, does she ever stop crying?
My daughter used to cry at night. This is when I was in Germany, and I used to have to like drive her around the block. My first daughter. All the rest of my kids were like great for sleeping. But
yes, we did the same thing for Hazel. We had to drive around the block just to get her to be quiet.
Yeah, you're like, everyone's like, man, you get a new black eye. No, these are bags, bro. These are bags. Been up all night dealing with this.
Yeah, and some people, you know, get luck out not knowing that feeling.
Right.
Like, you're lucky.
Yeah.
Then, you know, 3 years later, we have our next child, Scarlett.
And where'd you get, how'd you come up with her name?
Her dad.
Her
dad. Scarlett Johansson from the movie The Marvels, Avengers. So, yeah, got that from that.
Nice.
And Scarlett was perfect angel.
Yeah, we got another parallel existence. Yeah,
perfect baby, eat, sleep, did nothing. Like, all right, well, let's try for another one.
You at this point like, dude, we got to go one more so we can get the boy?
Yeah, that's
because that's where I was at. I had two girls up front. I'm like, come on, man. Like, I've been grappling my whole life. I need somebody that I can train with, you know?
Right. That was my initial thought. Like, the third one has to be a boy. Like, I had to get lucky somehow.
It's probably for that spider bite. You get the third one.
Yes. And boom, we find out it's a girl. And I was, you know, I say I was kind of heartbroken in a way, but, you know, God does mysterious things.
Yeah.
And he works in mysterious ways. And, you know, I accepted it. And her name is Vanna. And the reason why I got Vanna is listen to the Nelly song.
Nice.
And he says Vanna White in the song. Like, you know, I like that name, Vanna.
Yeah.
And I talked to her about it, and she was worse than Hazel at birth. For the first 6 months, I thought I was going insane.
Yeah.
She was very colic, worse than Hazel, and now she's still ornery.
Was that the little one that I seen when we were doing your interview?
Yes.
Running around throwing the hula hoop around.
Oh no, that was Scarlett.
Scarlett.
That was Scarlett. Yeah, that's Scarlett and Hazel.
Nice.
Yeah, so I won't take Vanna with me nowhere. Not yet.
Wait till they get a little bit older, you know, like, I can remember when I can remember walking out of movie theaters because my kids were just being so obnoxious. Like, I'm out of here.
Right. So yeah, we, you know, I'm overruled by women in my life. So.
Isn't that interesting? Like, how the balance, right? You're obviously an alpha, right? You're a very masculine dude, which attracts a lot of young men to you, right? Yeah. But like, you get balance because you're surrounded by feminine, you know, you're surrounded by a lot of women in your home.
Right. Yep.
So which I guess, you know, one critique I would have about myself is like, you know, my first, you know, 5-6 years in the military after gaining like, you know, rank, I guess, authority, you know, I'd come home with that. So right. I'd have to make a process for myself to take my boots off at the door and take my uniform off immediately so I didn't go into like sergeant mode, drill right. sergeant mode on right. my kids and my spouse. So it's like, you know, we get shaped. God shapes us and, yes. and sends people in our lives for certain reasons. So
right. Yeah. So I you know, very similar, you know, I got to remember when I walk through that door, it's family time. It's, I got to be present for my wife and kids. And cause I get, sometimes I'll get stuck in a mode where like, I'm still, when I get home, I'm still thinking about wrestling.
Yeah. You're like sprawl.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. I'm replaying situations in my head. Like, why is he not doing this right? Why is he not doing this right? Or why can we not pull the trigger on the shot? You know, that all those little things just replay in my head 24/7. And I was like, I want to win. I want to win.
Yeah. Yeah.
I want these kids to be successful. I want them to have that one moment where like, you know, you won a national title. Like I want them to have that. Cause it's a feeling that not many people get.
Yeah. And I think it shifts generations too, you know, like inside of families, it builds stronger core for a champion lifestyle,
yes.
not just on the mat, but like, yeah, those successes are, you know, what the result of those successes look like, you know, right. and it's a hard chase to get there.
Right.
Cause not every kid's going to get there. So.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. And it's the countless hours and discipline and hard work in the room as well to get that feeling back.
Yeah. Yeah. And I'm glad that you're on the podcast so we can kind of talk about this. Cause I think it's important for, you know, yeah, youth athletes to be able to see their coaches actual, like we come home from practice and we're still running scenarios, you know, you yep. wish you could get each individual those specific details, you know, but it's like, you got to spread it out in your mind with your family and have that balance as well.
Right.
So is your little girl's going to wrestle or?
I hope one of them does, you know, the oldest one, she's big in cheerleading right now. Loves it and she's really good at it and she plays soccer as well. Second child, Scarlett, she's we try getting her soccer, she's a little too young. And they're all summer babies, so when they play USA, they're never the oldest. They're the middle or the youngest.
Right. Right.
So we try getting Scarlett into soccer this year. She's just not quite there yet. Hopefully next summer she'll be, you know, competitive. And Vanna, you know, everyone says she's going to be my wrestler. So we'll see.
That's why she is the hardest, because she's probably most likely.
Yeah, probably. Probably most likely. Right.
That's pretty awesome. So let's, so thank you for sharing your family story. So let's go back in time. Let's shoot way back. You talked about your introduction to wrestling. Like, where did that like evolve from? Like your very first, like, hey, you know, like I want to try this, or this is something I want to do.
Right. Right. I remember in first grade going out, my friend was wrestling and he lived up right up the road from me. And I want to wrestle and be hanging out with him at nighttime.
Yeah.
And got the wrestling. And I can remember, you know, doing the basic penetration step for the most part, trying to shoot a high crotch, you know, single, very simple stuff. I remember going to my first wrestling tournament at the state tournament. And I don't remember losing the match, or not losing the match, but getting beat during the match. I thought I was winning the whole time, and I end up pinning the kid, and I guess I was losing the whole time.
Yeah.
I never knew that. So my very first tournament, I got first.
That's awesome.
Yep. Then
I did not. I showed you my medal. I got fourth at mine.
Right. Then my second tournament, I got second. Then my third tournament, I got third. Then that was the season. You know, I was like, well, that's it. That's what we're doing. And Dad's like, yep, that's the season. And we never had Super Pee Wee State growing up. We had AE State.
Yep.
Second grade year, my second year wrestling, I think I went 55-5. So a tremendous jump from the year before to the next year. And ever since then, it's kept on progressing every year. I remember going to AU districts my third grade year, and it was a tight match. I think I won and on like last 20 seconds of the match. I remember wrestling in the gym and I remember breathing heavily and I shot a double from probably 5 feet away. And I got the double leg takedown and beat the kid. I don't know who it was, but it was a tough kid at that time for me. It was. And I go to state tournament and it's at the U.S. Cellular Center. That's what it's called.
Yep. Back then. Is that at Cedar Rapids?
Yes, yeah, Cedar Rapids. Yeah, yes. Yeah. And I remember being, you know, gun shy.
Yeah, I remember being in that tournament too and seeing the size of the brackets.
Right, exactly.
I was like, what? Right. I've been used to wrestling, you know, three kids on the weekends, and now I got to sustain this.
Right, exactly. And you know, you get there and you're like, whoa, culture shock, right?
Yeah.
You're surrounded by everybody. You haven't seen these people before. Big arena, you know, your dad has to like walk you down, guide you down the hallway and everything. Like it's 'cause the culture shock. And I get there and I think I go 1-2, 0-2. I can't remember. First year I stayed.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's tough. And, you know, going back, you know, to like fourth grade through till my seventh grade year, you know, I'd always win these, you know, local tournaments on the weekends. Then when I get to state, I would kind of not choke, but like just wouldn't perform because
it's just a bigger environment, a lot to take in.
So I remember my seventh grade year, you know, I would win districts every year and go to state and not do well. And to a point where, you know, it's like, what's going on? There's something else going on. You know, my dad knew it. My dad was kind of hard on me growing up.
Sure.
And he would kind of, you know, push me to the edge of like almost not wanting to quit, but also wanting to like to win so bad to make him shut up in a way.
Yeah.
You know, and it's good that he pushed me because he knew the potential I had.
Yeah.
And I had a mental block at the big shows. I don't know why. I just froze. And, you know, every kid goes through that phase. Mm-hmm. Everyone does. So I remember my seventh grade year, you know, I remember beating some tough kids during that year. And I get there, I lose a tough match, I think in the quarters, and I'm in the blood rounds. And I'm beating the kid 11-0, round before the blood rounds, beating the kid 11-3. And I kind of got a little cocky and I did a half-ass stand-up and I got a cradle pin. Mm. And I freaked out. I mentally freaked out bad. And I remember on the way home, I broke down to the car. Dad's yelling at me. Mom's yelling at me. She wasn't like yelling, but like, you know, just telling me like stuff that she saw during the match. Like, Mom, you don't know what you're talking about. But she did.
Yeah,
moms know. They see stuff.
They collect the data.
Yes.
They know what's going on.
And I remember telling my dad, I want to go to Folkstyle Nationals. It's like, we ain't going. We're not going. We're not
you ain't ready.
Yeah. I'm not going to waste my time and money going down there. And I remember going to practice at Johnson High School. And I'm like,
Which is before they got the cool gym they have now.
Yeah. It was the old high school. And, you know, that's where I met Al Garrison. That's where I met Anthony Purcelli. You know, all the Johnson wrestlers.
What was Anthony Purcelli doing over at Johnson?
I can't remember.
Because he's out in Pleasant Hill.
Right.
Well, he was in East Des Moines when I met him.
Yep.
Yeah.
So he was in Johnston's room. And I remember looking at this guy. He's sitting there in a hooded sweatshirt, you know, raggedy sweatpants. I'm like, who is this guy? You know, then you see all these other people coming. I didn't know who Al Garrison was either.
Yeah.
I don't know none of these guys. We get there and a bunch of older men running practice and like, well, geez, these guys might know some things. And, you know, we started training those guys. And I remember, you know, I think the week before Folkstyle Nationals, my dad kind of gave in and said, yeah, okay, well, we're going to go. And I was like 8 pounds over. I'm like, geez, I got to lose 8 pounds in a week. I can't remember how I did, but I did it.
Yeah.
And I think it's going through my maturity stage as well. You know, it's going in.
Your body's fighting.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because I was 100 pounds my seventh grade year, and my eighth grade year went up to 125. And I think I was going through that stage of maturity, and I dropped the weight. And I remember going down there, my thought process has changed. I started listening to music before I wrestle, and I always listen to, you know, like Eye of the Tiger, stuff like that. Rocky stuff, you know. I used to watch Rocky movies a lot. And listen to songs that got me ready, got me to go. And I remember being positive, self-positive talk. You know, I'm going to win this match. I'm going to take this guy down. I'm going to shoot my single leg. You know, I'm going to shoot my high crotch when he does this. This thing, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And first round match, you know, I drew a really good wrestler from Missouri. And my dad's like, well, he ain't going to win. You know,
just go out there and do your best.
Right, right.
Try not to get pinned.
Right, exactly. You know, I didn't know that time that my dad thought that, but after, you know, after the tournament, I was like, yeah, I didn't think he was going to win that first match because he knew the wrestler was from Missouri. And I go out there and I beat him. Then I wrestled next hit, I beat him. Day two, I had a kid from Minnesota. I lost first round. Then I told myself, you know, I'm not leaving this arena without being on that podium.
Yeah.
And boom, I win my next two matches. I'm on the podium. And right then and there, like, I knew what I had to do to be successful. And I got on the podium, my first time ever placing on the national level scene. I get fourth at Topeka, Kansas Nationals, Folkestyle Nationals, which is now in Cedar Falls. Mm-hmm. I get fourth. And from there on, you know, I take that process of my mental game and I go down to Eden, Oklahoma, and place in Greco and Freestyle Nationals later that summer.
And now at this age and this timeline, how big is the freestyle Greco scene? Because when I was in high school, and I'm probably like, what, 10 years older than you?
Yep.
I'm 45.
Yep, I'm 30.
So, like, I was one of the only few kids in my school that wrestled freestyle or Greco.
Right.
And it wasn't a huge scene at the tournaments. It was very small.
Right, yeah. I can't recall how big the bracket was. I remember wrestling a kid from California, and he beat me in Greco for the All-American match for third and fourth. He was a tough kid. You know, I remember wrestling kids from Nebraska, mostly Midwest kids, you know. Didn't see really much of, you know, kids from other states there. I'd say maybe, you know, 16, 32-man bracket at least. You know, freestyle is always bigger. You know, it's more popular.
Yeah.
And I love Greco. And, yeah, I would say 16, 32-man brackets for sure down there. And like I said, you know, that thought process from Folkestyle Nationals, so I took it down to Schoolboy. It was called Schoolboy National Duel, or Schoolboy Nationals. Now it's called 14U. So I might say Schoolboy a lot here on the podcast.
That's all right. It's all good.
Might confuse some people. It's just like Schoolboy or no, not correct, 14U. But yeah, took it to, I placed at Nationals for 14U down there. And going into my eighth grade year, I was on a mission. Never placed at the AAU state tournament. Never have. Came close, you know, one or two times. And I told myself I'm going to win that tournament this year.
Yeah.
I remember going to like every tournament of the week, just to chase down everyone, every competition I went to, as far as the eastern side of the state, as far as to the western side of the state. You know, me and my dad traveled a lot that year, my third year, just to hunt down everybody in the state, you know, to wrestle at least one time.
Yeah, yeah.
And I get to the state tournament, and we see my bracket, and we see that I have a kid that I lost to earlier in the year from LaPorte City. Union LaPorte City, Zach Williams. And he was a tough competitor. And I had him in the quarters. And I remember I was hitting a switch this whole year, my third year, a standing switch. And I got that on him in the quarters, beat him by a reversal. And then I wrestled a kid in the semis that I wrestled earlier in the year. I think I beat him like 10-0 or something like that. And early in the year, then I get to state. You know, it's a closer match. Tough kid. Then the finals, I wrestle a kid from Dubuque, Noah Southworth, and beat him in overtime. I remember taking a single leg shot. I knew I had to get to a single leg arm. That's how I was going to beat him. I had a game plan. Even though I didn't know it was a game plan, I knew.
That's what you were going to do, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And I shoot that single leg in overtime, and you know, I get to the corner, pull my head out, get on top, boom, two. And that excitement was, you know, one of those excitements that, you know, you rarely get. You know, a lot of people don't get that. And that feeling, you know, I'll never forget.
Yeah.
And I want that feeling every time I wrestle now. Every time I go to the tournament, I want that feeling. Mm-hmm. And that's the feeling, you know, that you get once, you know, every year.
Or yeah.
Maybe twice a year. You know, it just depends on, you know, how much you do to wrestle. And that mindset and that kid who beat me my seventh grade in New York State, you know, whoever it was, thank you.
Yeah.
Because you've woken up a demon inside me. And I took that thought process, that mental game, everything. I take 10 times more serious, and it stuck with me throughout my whole wrestling career.
Yeah. Isn't it interesting, like, those hard losses are the ones that accelerate you?
Yes.
So you had some pretty good successes in middle school.
Yes.
Right. And then, let's walk fast forward into high school.
Okay. Yeah. So freshman year, you know,
you went to Sadel, right?
Yep. Sadel High School. Yep. In Des Moines. I remember having Coach Gary McCall, you know, I remember the speech, not word for word, but I remember him saying, you know, we had a goal sheet. And I was like, don't tell me what your goals are. Believe, you know, he's like, tell me what you really want to do. Like, what do you really want to do?
Mm-hmm.
It's like, all right, I'm going to be a 4-time state champ. You know, then he's like, what are you going to do to be a 4-time state champ? What are you going to do to get there? What's the process going to be like? How are you going to get there? You know, what are you going to do to get that? And I, you know, written out a roadmap how I was going to do it. Then we get to work right away. He was offering, you know, morning workouts in the morning. I try to get to most of those morning workouts as much as I can. Then we had school practice in the evening, and going into my freshman year, you know, we had some tough kids, you know, some tough losses. You know, I probably had the toughest district in the state that year.
And what was Sadel that year? What was Sadel when you were in high school? Were they 1A, 2A, 3A?
2A.
2A.
And we had a solid team. You know, sectionals. The conference was tough. It was called the Raccoon River Conference at the time. We had Ballard.
Yeah.
Carlisle. A lot of tough schools in there. At the time, it was tough. And I had Barrett Hoppenworth from Ballard. He's been on the podium, I want to say, sophomore year. He's gotten the podium sophomore year. He's a junior, was a freshman. Very tough kid, you know, very first time I wrestled him. I lost in overtime to him at Ballard. And I see him again. We're in a conference tournament, and I didn't get the chance to wrestle Clayburg from DCG because he was hurt when we dueled him in the regular season. And you know, you had Brad Parker from Winterset. I'm trying to think of all these names. my bracket was tough.
One of them's going to hit you up like, bro, you didn't even say my name.
Right. Probably will get a message here. But yeah, I remember wrestling, Ryan Byler from Winterset. He was tough. He beat me too in the regular season. He beat me at home. And that kid was tough to wrestle. Very defensive. And me and Coach McCall and my dad, you know, my dad recorded every match that he could.
So your parents are pretty involved in the game with you?
Yes, very involved. And we recorded every single match. And I remember going home, you know, even from my youth days, watching film with my dad. You know,
was that an enjoyable process, or was that like?
Nah, I'd say it's more enjoyable because I wanted to win, right?
Yeah.
You know, I wanted to learn how to beat these kids because next time I didn't want to lose them.
Sure.
I hate losing.
Did your dad wrestle, or he just?
Yep, dad wrestled only in high school. I think he was a state qualifier his junior year, then his senior year he didn't qualify. Had a chance to go, but I think he, I can't remember what the situation was. I think he got third at districts, and the kid got hurt, and he couldn't make the weight.
What? Where did he wrestle at?
Sadel.
Oh, that's cool.
Yes. Yep. So yeah, I remember conference semis. I had wrestled Ryan Byler, and he did match. You know, we were going back and forth. You know, scoring points. Like I said, he was a very defensive wrestler, and watching film on him, you know, had to get to an angle, could get to a single. I had to push one side and make him step one way and shoot a single leg as soon as he stepped. And as soon as he did, boom, I pulled the trigger, take him down, and I win the match by a point. Then on the other mat, Clayburg was wrestling Hoppenworth. And, you know, Hoppenworth was the guy to beat, and Clayburg beat Hoppenworth.
So it's the upset of the tournament.
Yep, upset. Yeah, you had the 3 seed beat the 1, and I was the 4 seed, and I beat the 2. And, or I can't remember, 3 beats 2, 4 beats 1. And so me and Clayburgh in the finals, my first time wrestling Clayburgh, and I beat him, I think, 7-3 in the finals. And I remember getting in the hallway, just pacing back and forth, probably like an hour before the match. And, you know, I wanted to win. So
and this
bad.
Is over at Vets, right?
No, this is at a conference tournament.
Oh, the conference tournament,
yeah,
right.
I think it was at Perry, I think. And, yeah, I remember warming up like a long time before that match, and I couldn't wait. I wanted to go wrestle and go win. And I did. I got the job done. And sectionals is like a week later, and I wrestle Hoppenworth in the finals, and he beat me early in the year, and I think I ended up beating him like 5-3, and I remember like, whoa, I just did this.
Yeah, you got the turnaround going.
Right, right. He's a state place winner, you know. Thoughts are going inside my head, you know, I can do this. I can really, mm-hmm. I can mm-hmm. go get this job done. And districts, you had me, Hoppenworth, Byler, all ranked kids.
Stacked. You got a stacked house.
And the 4th kid was from Creston. I think he upset Clayburgh at his sectional tournament. And so I had the kid from Creston first round. I think I ended up pinning him. Then Ryan Byler beats Hoppenworth. And that was a shock.
Yeah.
Like, whoa. And going into that finals match with Ryan Byler, you know, he was tough. I was nervous because, like, he's very hard to score on. Very tough, strong, short, stocky kid. Tough to wrestle. And he gets a reversal on me within the last, like, 15 seconds of the match. And I'm like, oh, crap.
Yeah.
I gotta go. And I hit a switch. I can't remember what I hit. I think he threw a leg in and I hit a switch and I reversed him. And it was like 4 seconds left on the clock and boom, I won the match. And I remember just like breathing like, whoa.
Yeah. I'm sure that 4 seconds felt like an eternity.
Yes, it did. It did. Really did. And you know, the thoughts going through your head, like I gotta get off bottom.
Yeah.
I gotta get off bottom because, you know, Hoppenworth wanted me, you know, you know. I had to lose that match for me to wrestle him for true second.
Sure.
And I didn't want to wrestle for true second. And I hit that switch at the last, you know, 4-10 seconds left in the period and ended up winning the district tournament. Going into state, you know, I had a kid from Osceola first round, beat him. Second kid, I had Pat Blanchard from Glenwood. Tough kid as well. Place winner last year. And going back to the freestyle and Greco, you know, I was really good at upper body stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And Pat Blanchard, you know, want to go upper body with me. And I remember throwing him right to his back in the first 30 seconds of the match.
Nice.
Got a 5-0 lead right away. Then the remainder of the match, you know, it was close. You know, I think only points that he scored on me were escapes. Then I had one more takedown and that was the match, really.
Yeah.
But I can't thank, you know, All Season Wrestling for that opportunity that he gave me, because if it wasn't for that, then who knows if I would have beat him or not.
Yeah, where you'd been set at, yeah.
Exactly. Then I had a kid from Clear Lake in the semis, Corey Dwyer, same thing. He started going upper body with me, threw him right to his back 3 or 4 times. I don't know why I hit a wall in this match, but I did. Like, I think my nerves got to me, and I just gassed myself out, but I hit a wall, and that kid came all the way back and almost beat me in the semis.
Mm.
I think I ended up winning 11-10. I was beating, like, 8-0.
Your coach is probably, like, freaking out.
Yes. Remember, like you said, Vets, right?
Yeah,
everybody's right on top of you.
Like the barn.
Yes, everybody's right on top of you. Like, here's the mat, and here's 2 feet of walkway, then the kids.
Yeah.
So, yes, it was very intense. Like I said, I hit a wall and I end up beating the kid. He put a cradle on me like the last 15, 20 seconds of the match, and he had to pin me to win. And all I had to do was fight hands. You know, I remember
grab his hands.
And I didn't grab the hands, and he gets me on my back, and I'm like bridging up off my back. I've got my hand on the mat. I'm trying to push up.
You're levitating off the ground.
Yes. So, yeah, I ended up winning that match in finals match.
And this is your freshman year, too,
freshman
right?
Freshman year, yeah. Yes.
Yeah. What weight was this at?
130.
130.
And freshman year, I get in the finals with Robert Struthers. And I remember that wall that we talked about.
Mm-hmm.
That wall came back. That mental block hit me again. And I was like, during that match, you know, I wasn't feeling myself. I wasn't TJ.
I just
went back to old TJ.
Yeah, yeah.
And I lose 5-0. Could have done better, probably, you know. But
you just felt more disappointed in the fact that you couldn't give 100% of your mental capacity.
Right.
But that, I mean, you're a freshman taking, that's a lot taken on, you know, to take on, to absorb the environment. I always talk about people about staying focused is about absorbing your environment, you know, absorb the moment that you're in. But sometimes if you absorb too much, you're taking in way too much data and information and you get overloaded.
Right, exactly. And I was so disappointed in myself. That was tough. You know, I'd say second place is probably like the worst feeling at state. You got 15,000 people looking at you, watching wrestling. And
the kid that doesn't place is probably like, what are you talking about? But yeah, exactly. I understand what you're saying.
Second place is, it just sucks. Then after state tournament, you know, I get right into freestyle and Greco season.
Mm-hmm.
Fargo. I won one Fargo.
Yeah.
And I'm wrestling, got in the dual teams, cadet duels, which is called 16U now, on duels wrestling. And I wrestle 140, and I'm doing well. You know, I develop a left side headlock when I was at duels. I had to wrestle a tough competitor named John Reeder, and he beat the crap out of me. You know, I think I was the only kid in the last, you know, all of the periods with him at duels, but he was tough. Big, strong kid. I don't think I scored a point. I think he beat me 4-0 in the first period. In the second period, he came out and tech-followed me. And after that match, I kind of like thought some things over. What could I have done different? You know, I'm listening to Coach Jason Christensen. Mm-hmm. He was our coach for a year. And that's where I was going to Southeast Polk, too, training with him over there with all the Southeast Polk guys. And everybody else was going there as well. And I developed a left-side headlock at duels and I started hitting that more often. Like, well, this feels natural. I'm not left-handed. I'm right-handed.
Yeah, yeah.
I kick a ball with my right leg, with a pin with my right arm, you know. And Christian was showing us, you know, left side underhooks. You know, keep your shooting hand free, and all of a sudden, I developed this left side headlock, and it felt so smooth, so natural. It felt amazing.
I think there's something about left-handedness, like with striking too, is like you're able to relax that a little bit more. Like throwing a football left-handed is not great, but like throwing a kick left-footed is like, it feels more relaxed.
Right.
You know, and you develop that relaxedness compared to the tenseness of like doing it from your right-hand side.
Right, exactly. And so at duels, I developed this left-side headlock, hitting it. It was going smooth. I think the second day at duels, I went undefeated. I think I went 8-1 at duels that year. Then freestyle would come around. I think the team went, you know, 7th place. I can't remember. It's a long time ago, but mm-hmm. did well as a competitor as well. I may have lost a couple matches in freestyle, but then Fargo's coming. I go to Fargo camp for a week, and Greco was the first session at Fargo, and I'm beating people left and right. I was on a mission.
Yeah, you're hungry.
Yeah, exactly, hungry. And I beat a tough kid from Maryland. His name was Aaron Savon. He was beating me during the match. And I hit that left side headlock out of nowhere. He didn't see it coming. Hit him, beat him. I think I beat him 5-3. Then the next day, I had wrestled Kyle DeBerry from Arizona. And during that match, I wasn't feeling myself again. You know, I was ready to wrestle, but I wasn't getting to my stuff that I usually do. I think, you know, he studied tape on me really well, and I wasn't getting to my moves, wasn't getting to my underhooks, wasn't getting to nothing. And he like always countered what I did and did a really good job of wrestling me. And I ended up losing like, I think by a point to him. And I remember breaking down crying and, cause I wanted to win Fargo so bad. I wanted the stop sign really bad. And I remember on the phone talking to my dad.
Stop sign, he means the plaque.
Yes, the plaque, yes.
Everybody's like, what? You get a stop sign at the end of all that?
And So Kyle DeBerry had to wrestle Aaron Savon. And I had, so the line is, the brackets that we have at Fargo are line bracketing. And not too few people know what those are, but if you lose, still had a chance to win. You could be in the final still. And Aaron Savon beat Kyle DeBerry, and I had to tech fall this kid from Montana or pin him to get points. So like the line bracket, he had a, if you get a tech fall, I think you get like 4 points. You get a pin, you get mm-hmm. 4 points. And when it gets down to the last three wrestlers of the bracket, on so like say my bracket was 32-man bracket, the top three kids from the top side and the top three kids from the bottom side of the bracket get put into a pool in the middle. One versus one, two versus two, three versus
Is that
three.
Still the same way
no.
that they run it now?
Nope, totally different now. Now it's just straight across bracket, regular size, or normal bracketing.
Without winner and consolation side.
Yep, all that, yeah. So I had different rules
and what, yeah,
people,
yeah.
what people know now. And so, and on the other side of the bracket, so my bracket at Fargo was a 108-man bracket.
Jesus.
There's an A bracket and there's a B bracket. And I end up winning my bracket, even though I lost. I had more points, and I had head-to-head win over Aaron Savon, which Kyle DeBerry lost to. And on the B bracket, same situation over there. Brent Haynes lost to somebody. I can't remember who he lost to, but he's from Missouri. And we end up seeing each other in the finals at Fargo. And I knew who Brent Haynes was. His teammate, Shane Nay, was a really good wrestler. We always saw them at national tournaments, mm-hmm. Wrestling, you know, at freestyle and Greco tournaments, regionals, all that fun stuff. And so I knew who Brent Haynes was. There was a group of Missouri kids that stuck together from Kansas City area, and they were the guys to beat.
Yeah.
And Shane Nay, Brent Haynes, you know, those guys were the guy to beat. And I'm in the finals match. I remember sleeping on my shoulder wrong. I couldn't lift my shoulder in the morning. I'm like, oh, come on. You know, like, I'm in the finals. Like, I'm sore already.
Yeah.
I can't lift my arm up. It's like, so I'm rehabbing my arm, icing it, you know, doing like little stretches to get it loose. And I'm warming up at Fargo, getting ready to go. Got good sweat going. And getting that finals match, I knew I got a score. I had to score. Got a score on this kid right away. Well, nobody ends up scoring. So we go to overtime. And I'd never been overtime in Greco before. This is my first time ever being overtime in Greco. And it was the clinch.
Mm-hmm.
And on our feet, so body locks. And I'd never been in overtime. I'm looking at Coach Christian like, and like, dude, like,
we didn't practice
this. Like, well, we did, but like, I don't know. Like, I wasn't the best at it.
Yeah.
I wasn't the best in that position. And
especially when you're starting in it, you're already starting in a right. unfavorable position.
Right. And so I won the toss, and I had first choice to score, or first choice to lock,
mm-hmm.
which I wasn't a fan of. I want to lock second. And so I get in there, you know, there's little, you know, little tricks. They know how to get in a better position. And, well, I end up locking my lock on the wrong side of my left side headlock. And I noticed that as soon as I locked my hands. And I'm like, oh, no, I got my hands locked on the wrong side of the body. And I get really nervous. So I got my hands locked. Then Brent Haynes, you know, he lowers his level. And he's grabbing his butt on a singlet, trying to lift his shoulder up to get my lock above his shoulder.
Mm-hmm. And that's your bad shoulder side?
Yep. And he did it. And so my lock's loose. It's not tight. And the person who had a lock first had to score. If mm-hmm. you didn't score in the first, I think, 30 seconds, you'd give up a point. And so he gets my lock loose, whistle blows, he locks the whistle blows, and I'm like, I got nothing but a right side headlock. My lock's so loose, it's up by his head. And he was really doing a really good job of keeping his head or his shoulders tucked by his ears, you know, so he has a short neck, and I mm-hmm. can't grab his head. And we're both in the body lock, and if you broke your lock, you had to commit to another move right away. If you didn't, you give a point. So like weird rules compared to what we have now. and none of us broke our locks. And I'm like, I gotta hit a right side headlock. And I'm pushing, he pushes back, I push again. And soon as I felt that push back, I had to just rip a right side headlock, and I end up throwing him into the right side headlock. And I'm trying to remember how I caught his head. I know I pinched his head so hard. You know, the technique probably wasn't there.
Yeah, but it's all grit now.
Yeah, it's all grit. It's the dog in me coming out, and I just threw that headlock so hard and end up getting points when feet to back. And I hit the headlock, and he rolls through. I let go of my lock because I didn't want to get rolled through. I bailed the position, and we end up back on our feet. Now it's 3-0. And now it's a dog fight. Right now he's coming after. Now we're wrestling, and there's a position where I could have gotten a score, and I felt him do something weird, and like, that's not normal. So I just let go of my lock and got back in better position. And the remainder of the match, I think I won 3-0. And but the last, like, I came down like the last 30 seconds where we're both just hand fighting the crap out of each other, trying to get to a tie that we're good at, and it was a dog fight. And I won that match, and I just, like, I couldn't believe it for a split second. And I was like, yes, I did this. You know, I broke down in tears. So I was so freaking happy about winning that match, winning that tournament, because that's the tournament I was talked about. That's the tournament to win.
Yeah. Yeah. And like, so let's like put this in perspective a little bit. You know, you're a high school student, you know, the regular season wrestling is like where the school recognizes you and you're getting your like talent support. But then you go off and do this, and it's like, you're, you know, it's something your kids at your school aren't seeing, you know, right. But it's such a valuable thing. So to cap off your high school, so you had 2 state titles.
Yes.
4-time state qualifier.
Yes.
What did you place the other 2 years?
So freshman year got second, sophomore year got 7th, and junior senior I won it.
And junior senior won it, and then you went on to win Fargo.
Yes, won Fargo my freshman year. Won Folkstyle Nationals my freshman year. Sophomore year, I don't think I did Folkstyle Nationals. Got 7th my 7th grade year. Fargo got 3rd at the junior division. Then junior senior year I won state. Senior year I won Folkstyle Nationals. Then junior, I decided not to do Greco that year and try to get on the podium in freestyle. Came to a blood round match loss. Then blood rounds again my senior in Greco.
So all this, that's a lot.
Yeah,
you accomplished a lot in your 4 years in high school. So which like opens up a new corridor, because now you have colleges looking at you, and you're wanting to pursue wrestling further for another commitment of 4 years.
Yep.
So walk me through like you're graduating high school. You've already been looked at, you know where you're going to go type thing, or?
Yeah. So want to go to Division I. Had a lot of offers, you know, talking to a lot of colleges, Kale Sanderson, you know, Iowa State at the time, Chris Bono, Chattanooga, Nebraska, mostly Midwest states were talking to me, and come to it, you know, ACT score, you know, wasn't quite there. Sort of like, wasn't the best score, you know. Then you had to get a certain score to get into colleges, and I think I scored like 1 point below where I had to get in. And like, geez, I took that test like 3 times, got the same score every time. I wasn't the best test taker. Good on hands-on projects. Like if you throw a project from me, hands-on.
It's a different pressure.
Yeah.
You mastered the pressure in the wrestling room, but like academically, it is tough to like prep.
Right. You know, I say as a BC student, you know, I was always getting A's. You know, I stress that to my kids now. You know, you want to go to Division I, you got to have the grades. You got to do it. You know, it's part of it. You know, they're not going to want somebody who they're at the babysit 24/7 either.
Sure.
And like I said, good on hands-on, but when it came to test, it was like, I can't do it. I don't know why.
Yeah.
Didn't quite figure that out till my senior year in college. You know, And I struggled throughout college, you know, trying to get by. It was tough. You know, JUCO, went to JUCO my first 2 years of my college career. Went to NIAC. I got third at JUCOs in school. You know, I was a C average student.
Yeah. You know, it was and where were you at?
NIAC.
At NIAC.
Up in Mason City. Got my A degree then. And
what'd you get your degree in?
Just associates in arts.
Associates in arts.
Yep. You had to get like 60 credits. Yeah. Just a basic degree to just go on to your next.
Yep.
To your next stint for college. So get my A degree. You know, I'm going all, I had four rides. You know, to not St. Cloud State, but like Newberry, St. Cloud State was looking at me in Minnesota. A lot of Division II, Division III's, NEIA's were looking at me, and I end up going to Wartburg. Right out of JUCO's, you know, once they close to home, and you know, my dad was always traveling to watching me wrestle, and it was good to have him there to watch me wrestle, and to having a really successful season, doing really well, wrestling tough competition, wrestling tough kids, beating all tough kids, and I get a back injury, and that put a halt to a lot of things in my ability. Never really got it really diagnosed, really, and I wish I would have, but at the time I had no money, nothing. Probably couldn't get a medical retro because I was so far into the season.
Sure.
And I'm sitting here trying to rehab my back to back healthy, and I never got healthy.
Yeah, it's degenerative, probably. Yeah, it just keeps getting worse.
Yes, it was one of the worst pains I ever felt in my life. End up losing my spot, and my mental state was not quite there either. Had a family relative that was not in good health conditions either. She later passed away that summer. That's close to our family, you know, close to my family personally. And at that point, I was like, I want to be done wrestling. Like, my heart's just shattered.
Yeah.
And I've been on and off, you know, going in and cleaning the classroom too. I started, you know, not going to class. It's like, I'm done. I'm checked out.
Yeah, that's how it works, man. You get trials of many kinds, you know, and often when we hit those points, it just seems like that, not quitting, but that feeling of like loss, right, just starts building. You know, you had a loss from your back, you know, you lost your strength in your back, then your family member goes, and then, you know, your grades are, you know, it's just like boom, right, boom, boom, boom. It's
going, you know, one after another. And I remember in class one time at Wartburg, you know, and
what was your major there?
Sports management. And I was in a class, and a kid had a project. It was a project I had to do, and you know, I got upset with the professor, and because we did the exact same thing without, you know, not knowing that we did. And my way of describing it compared to his way of describing it was very similar, and I noticed that kid got a better grade than I did. I'm like, why'd he get this grade over, like,
yeah
what was different? And teacher really didn't give me a good explanation, and like right then and there, like, what is it then? You know, is it because I'm an athlete? What is, you know, these are going, and there, like I said, never got a good explanation of why. And I passed the class, but it's like, I could have got a better grade in that class.
Sure.
And I was like, and that kind of rubbed me the wrong way a little bit. And then I was like, you know, I'm just going to be done. I think school's not my thing. You know, I'm battling the teachers now.
Yeah.
And I was like, that's one thing you shouldn't do as a student. You shouldn't have to battle the teachers.
Yeah. Now. Yeah.
It wasn't like, I was
every student bad. Should be on the same playing field.
Right. Right. You know, like, I wasn't a bad student. It's just, I don't know what it was with that teacher, but I think, you know, they didn't like sports or something.
Didn't like the wrestlers.
Right. So I come home, you know, and my mindset's like, I think I'm done. I don't want to wrestle. And, you know, I've been talking to Coach Mitchell too at Grandview, and I sparked my interest to start back wrestling again. It's like, all right, I'll go wrestle. And get on campus. You know, I'm redshirting this year. I never took my redshirt at JUCO's. I never took my redshirt at Wartburg because you can't D3. It's 4 years straight. And I finally take my redshirt as a junior, as a true junior. And that whole year, you know, I'm wrestling tournaments, rehabbing my back, trying to get my back strong. Because I still dealing with issues with my back. And doing all the right things, you know, I wrestled 157 my redshirt year. Then going into my senior, I cut down to 149. It was a jaunt to get down there. I got big that summer by working out, lifting heavily. Weighing 174 down to 149, like
that's a big jump.
Yeah, it's a big jump, you know. And not knowing what we know now, right?
Right.
You know, everyone has meal plans. Everybody has.
There's a lot more information on how to properly reduce your weight.
Right. Yeah. And I wish I had those plans mm-hmm. to do that because mm-hmm. you know I did the as my senior I probably did it the absolutely best way I could. You know. Never wore a sauna suit, never did none of those things. Everything did the right way, did extra workouts, ate right, did everything right to a T. And, you know, there's some matches, you know, I'd probably get a little tired because of the weight cut.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, but it was, I would say my weight was more, it was manageable to maintain because I was doing so many workouts.
Mm-hmm.
Really didn't give myself a break though either.
Yeah.
Because I was doing so many workouts to keep my weight low. And that could have been from nutrition, you know.
Yeah. That's tough to manage over time, too. Right. It's not like you just did it once.
Right.
You know?
Right. It's, of course, the whole season. And there's times where I feel amazing. There's sometimes like, well, I feel like dog crap. Like,
yeah.
I was tired. You know, every first match I wrestled my senior year, I was tired. You know, this didn't feel good. But after that, I felt good throughout the day. Getting fluids back in my body, proper nutrition. But then sometimes later in the day, like, well, I'm just beat, tired, mm-hmm. wants to go to bed.
Yeah.
But I had mentally toughened out and wrestled that finals match or that third place match, you know, mm-hmm. throughout the tournament. But yeah, I ended up getting third my senior year at NAIA's, got third three times in college. Wish I would have been a four timer, you know, and it was good. It was fun. I wish I could go back and do it all over again, you know, knowing the stuff that I know now.
Yeah.
And go back and be that guy that could have been, you know, a national champ or a four-time national champ, you know, whatever it was. But yeah, it was good.
Well, you embraced your adversities. It's not like you just sat it out, you know. You pushed through it and you got what you got from it.
Right.
Grandview alumni, we're both Grandview graduates too. So, what was it like wrestling for Coach Mitchell?
It was awesome. You know, he
did he fit your style and your
Yeah, definitely. He's the man. You know, he said the right things to you. You know, he said very motivational things. He knew how to help you get over the hump. You know, it got tough. You got tough. We know we preach championship lifestyle. You know, you believe that, you do it every day, good things are gonna come to you. So, you know, start buy into the process, trust the process, you know, work hard, get extra workouts in, you know, because those guys are doing it too, probably. Mm-hmm. Why shouldn't you be doing it? If you want to be a national champ, you want to be on the podium, you better do extra workouts. You better do the right things. And so doing all these right things, and he also, you know, it felt good to have him in your corner. It's like you like level up one, you know, as a compare. Like, yeah, I got Coach Mitchell in my corner. We're gonna win this tournament. We're gonna win this match.
Yeah. Well, so you get done with college, you were successful. Maybe not where you would have liked to been, but you had a pretty successful college run. So now, where does that take you to where you get into your coaching path? Like, what made you decide, like, hey, I'm just done with wrestling. I'm going to go work and be an adult and family man.
Right.
And where do I, like, I know we got a little bit of your origin from how you got into coaching, but like, where did that, how did that process go?
Right. Yep. So, after college graduated, I became the head wrestling coach at Sadel. And when I was at Sadel, I was still, you know, working out as well. You know, I was competing. I went to Folk Style Veterans Nationals as I was a coach at Sadel, and I ended up winning that. I beat a Division I All-American from Chattanooga. And I thought it was kind of ironic because I wanted to go to Chattanooga, and I ended up beating him at in the finals at the Veterans Folk Style Nationals. And once I knew I won that, I was done competing. You know, I hung it up. I had to cut to 154 or 152 for that. And I decided to go full-time dedicated coaching.
Yeah, it's interesting, like, when people make that choice. Like, I still get messed with. People are like, are you going to compete anymore? Why don't you compete? I'm like, I'm 45 years old.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I give it all, you know, 7 days a week.
Right.
But, like I think with in jiu-jitsu, they don't see it that way. They're like, you should still be competing all the time to stay relevant. You
right,
know?
Exactly.
Like, I'm in the training room, you know, but, like, so you made your you made your coach's stint here, and so you went from Sadel, and then where'd you go on to after that? To Campbellsville?
Yep, Campbellsville University. Yep. And that's when we moved to Kentucky, me and the wife did. Coached 2 years and came back to Des Moines. I was helping out with Grandview University, coaching Waukee's youth program as well. Doing lots of things when I got back. Wife was working a full-time job on top of our daughter being born. I was working 2-3 jobs.
And what kind of employment was you doing around that time? Like, so where was your field at?
I was doing landscape when I got back.
Okay.
With a former teammate from Grandview.
Cool.
I was doing landscape, coaching college, and coaching youth wrestling at Waukee.
Busy man.
Busy, yes. Very, 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 very busy. And so I got narrowed down to two things. And I gave up college wrestling coaching, and I gave up the Waukee Youth Club, and I took on the reins of the Viking Wrestling Club and working one full-time job. And I was doing construction at the time when I was coaching the Viking Wrestling Club. Then I got a job at Wells Fargo, and I stayed there for a couple years. And
there's two places that people work in when you're in Iowa.
Right.
Wells Fargo's is one of them.
Right, exactly. Yep. So I was coaching Viking Wrestling Club and working at Wells Fargo for the remainder of the 2 years. And then that's when Wells Fargo, the year after, they let everybody off.
Yeah.
For the home mortgage. And that's where I was at, in the home mortgage department at that time.
And it's like, God's seeding your path, man.
Yeah, right.
You might not like it, but he's seeding it for you.
Right,
yeah.
Exactly. Then I was Lil's guy on the totem pole when they switched departments, and the hours that I had before they made the switch were amazing. Mm-hmm. I could get off in time, go be a family, and go coach wrestling. And when they switched, when they did the whole switch thing, it's like my schedule was chaotic. Yeah. So then I get a job at Perfect Cut Landscape as a production manager. Was there for a season and a half. Then all of a sudden, you know, I was thinking, oh, I want to be a full-time wrestling coach.
Yeah, yeah.
This is my passion. This is what I want to do. And that was a tough conversation to have with Coach Mitchell, you know, because I was doing really well at Viking Wrestling Club, and I decided to go do my own thing, and that's what I wanted
to do. Yeah, so walk me through that. So, like, walk me how the Moen Academy got it's like what year it's 2019 when you started, right?
Yep.
And give me some feedback about how that kind of that process went for you.
Yeah, so started Moen Wrestling Academy. You know, we were in the Dowling Room, started our first season. It was going smooth. I think we had 25, you know, roughly kids in the room from all ages. You know, it wasn't divided up like how it is now. And going smooth. Then later that season, you know, you hear about the sickness that's coming along, because they're calling it, you know, the flu on steroids, you know, and we didn't know what it was. You know, I got sick. I remember going to Tulsa in January, and I ended up getting sick when I got home. It wasn't bad, but I never get sick. Never. And I got sick. Then after districts, AU districts for the kids, I got really sick. Like, I had to go to hospital, and I had the worst migraine in my life, and I had to get a shot to get the migraine go away. And I never ever had to go to hospital to get a shot for a migraine before, and that's my first time ever. And they tested me for influenza A, B, didn't know, came back negative. I'm like, what do I have?
Mm-hmm. You got that first
yeah, that
vid?
First, yeah, that first vid. Yeah,
I won't say so they won't shut us down on the internet.
Right. Get that first wave of that crud. And I was out for a week. Hmm. And I remember the first 3 days is I couldn't get out of bed.
So, yeah. So the pandemic hit. You're like in the process, your first year, yeah. Really. That'd have been your first year over at the Dowling Room, and which I wrestled at Dowling as well as a youth. And then, yeah, that's that huge challenge. Like, what do I do now? You know, like messes with employment and all that other stuff. And then I know the state shut down. I know my gym got shut down.
Yep.
You know, I was in the middle of a reconstruction process on my building. And so, yeah, you're facing all these new challenges with the pandemic.
Yeah. So after AU State, you know, I get back, you know, like, whoa, you look different. Like, I feel different. So go to the state tournament. State tournament's over. We start freestyle and Greco season that year for the youth. And we get shut down. Mm-hmm. That was a big ordeal there. You know, you got people who, you know, were at expectations where, you know, the wrestle, and you know, you said you went through it. It was a tough time for a lot of us, and that's when we started working out in Coach Link's basement, holding like, you know, small group sessions. Mm-hmm. There then that following preseason, you know, had to buy wrestle mats, had to buy all the items for a wrestling room. I mean, a lot of people don't know what that takes.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, oh, it's not that much,
but you just really lay the mats and just go, right?
You know, and it's more than that.
Yeah.
You know, and it's very expensive. You know, I was, you know, you had a savings account and you drained it.
Yeah.
And I remember going in to see, like, oh,
it's hard. And it's hard to tell your spouse, I'm sure, to be like, hey man, we got to invest in us. And like, you know, there's that belief system of like, is it going to produce results, or are we just going to be blowing the money out?
Right. You know, you got to keep on paying coaches, insurance, you know, other fees on top of it, rent. Like, well, and I told you guys, well, count's not good, and here we go.
Yeah.
And we rolled into that next year of the wrestling season, and all of a sudden, boom, it kicked off. It was amazing. It's probably one of the best feelings I felt in a long time.
Same for me. I felt like after, you know, when they shut me down, I was like, man, this is it. You know, like, it's going to drown. It's going to die. And then as soon as the state releases back into being able to open back up, there was a lot of thriving going on.
Right. Yeah. So like, you know, we see places getting shut down from the COVID, and like, you don't want that.
Yeah.
It's a fear.
Yeah.
And you know, some people are upset with me, you know, and because, you know, I have a no refund policy on the website, and a lot of people didn't see that. And I told people, you know, hey, stay with me.
Yeah.
You'll get that credit.
Yeah. Yeah. I had, you know, a lot of my people stayed with me. You know, they're like, it doesn't matter.
Right.
But yeah, you had those other people that just, and they don't know what that does. You know, it's not like I make money at my gym. I keep the doors open.
Right, exactly. Doors open, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. The passion, if I didn't have passion for it, it wouldn't be happening.
Right.
So.
Exactly. You know, I love the sport of wrestling. I love what it does for me. And, you know, there's some times where I scratch my head like, yeah. There is some times I scratch my head, ask myself, what am I doing? But this is my life. This is my path.
Yeah.
And I'm going to do it.
And I'm super glad you're sitting here with me and hearing your experience about it, you know, because every one of your stories from when you were a kid, you know, middle school, to high school, to college, to life, it's like you're in your pursuit with Moen Academy. It's like you've had these like little moments where like, it's like someone's like, are you going to quit?
Yeah.
Are you going to quit?
Yep.
Okay. You're feeling it, but I'm going to put this on top of you too. And that's that perseverance that I love about you. And I see it in your teaching,
right.
You know, I see it in the way that you teach, that all of that comes out and relates to the kids. You know, that's why I said what I said about, you know, you're putting a stamp in there. You're getting them to know how to perform at the next highest level where there are going to be challenges.
Right.
So hats off to you for that.
Oh, thank you.
So last time before today, when I ran into you, was over at the Fargo training camp.
Yes.
So we've mentioned Fargo a couple times in already, but maybe you can kind of break down everybody here listening what Fargo is, and then maybe talk about the camp and preparation and some of your athletes that you will be competing.
Yep. So Fargo camp is a camp, you know, where all the kids in the state of Iowa that qualify for Fargo and who are pursuing to go wrestle at Fargo got to go to this camp. It's mandatory.
And that's like, there was like 200 kids, yeah. Some of the best wrestlers in Iowa.
Yep. Yep. And so, you know, when I was competing, you know, we had a specific Greco camp, a specific freestyle camp. And Greco camp was always, or Greco was first at Fargo, so Greco camp was first for, you know, for most states. And back then when I was competing, Greco camp was 4 days, I think 10 workouts. And now, you know, I think Iowa USA Wrestling has done a really good job, you know, of combining the two groups and making it, you know, less than 10 workouts. So this weekend was, you know, last weekend before the holiday was Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Two workouts, you know, Friday, three on Saturday, two on Sunday. Nothing too crazy. You know, the goal is not to beat the kids down and you know, hurt them or prevent injury. You know, the goal is to make sure their tools are sharpened, make sure they are ready, make sure they're competition ready, and make sure that we know how to defend, you know, guts, laces, wrestle certain situations. You know, every coach, you know, that was showed something at camp, you know, they may have a tweak, you know, to show something here or how to defend a single leg here or, you know, how to defend a gut here. You know, there's always, like you said, going earlier in the podcast, you know, all the knowledge that I know is from coaches, you know, giving me, you know,
or just pieces of the puzzle.
Yeah. And these coaches, you know, we're at this camp where, you know, we're throwing different pieces at you. Hey, you may react better to this, or you may try this. And heck, that one thing might win you a match that you need to be an All-American or a national champ. You never
left
know.
Side head toss.
Right, exactly. You just never know. So yeah, that's what, you know, that's what camp's all about. It's coming there, learning, you know, one thing here or there, and if it feels good, do it. And then, you know, after camp, you know, you take off, and the goal is to keep training, right? Mm-hmm. The goal is the camps. You're not done training,
right? That's just built for maintenance,
right? Yeah. Exactly. These kids are still going to go to their clubs or to their high schools and work out, and you know, like we had practice. I told my guys, hey, take Monday, Tuesday off for recovery. You know, you just did 8-10 workouts, and take Monday, Tuesday off for recovery, rest. Then we'll see you Wednesday morning. And 99% of my guys showed up.
Right.
And we had to work. You know, not a hard workout in the morning, but like, hey, warm up, drill, spar. You know, I'm a big fan on sparring. Mm-hmm. With our kids,
me,
you know,
too.
Just constantly moving. Just keep tell your mind to keep moving. Wrestle, put yourself in certain positions where you're not comfortable in, and wrestle that position. And that's what we did Wednesday morning. Then we were back in the room Thursday night at Simpson, you know, regular time, and it was hard practice. And then Friday, Saturday's off. Back in the room on Sunday. Then back in the room Tuesday, Thursday. Then I take off myself Friday morning to get to for the girls to go coach the girls wrestling.
So you got how many Moen athletes will be competing at Fargo?
With girls and boys, say, you know, combining, you know, so we have some guys competing at freestyle and Greco, and women's, I say we're, you know, 20 plus athletes. And my brother, he's going to be a coach up there with me as well. He's going to be on the Greco staff, and I'll be coaching freestyle.
Awesome. So I was talking to one of your athletes. I was talking to Dustin Harper last night. Norwalk had their outdoor wrestling event last night, which went pretty awesome. Yeah. Tyler didn't wrestle in it. I think he's got a little bug in him right now.
Yep.
But he was, you know, talking about the size of the bracket. He's like, it's already up to like 52, you know, like just to give us a short little insight on just like kind of like this, you know, where Fargo's at, how important is this tournament for youth athletes?
Right. So yeah, Fargo's in North Dakota. Some people take their vacation there. For me, it's not a vacation spot. It's a business trip for me.
Trust me. I actually looked. I was like, what is there to do around Fargo? It's like it may drag one of my kids so they don't have to see me watch wrestling all day. But just, yeah, there's really not that much to do out there.
So I would say there's more to do now than there was 13 years ago, 15 years ago. the town has developed, and this, you know, there's more options to do now, or more activities to do there now than there was back then when I was competing. Because I have brothers too. My brother, you know, he went there with my mom and dad, and all my other, I got two brothers below him, so they had to stay busy with keeping those guys entertained as well, you know, like mini golf.
See, this is why you got so many girls, because you got so many brothers.
Yes, yeah.
That's what it is, the balance.
You're probably right. But yeah, so yeah, Fargo's in North Dakota. It's a boring, long drive, especially if you're, you know, losing weight.
Hot boxing in the car?
Yeah, pretty much. Yep. I remember we had a kid last year at Fargo. We get to the hotel, and he is struggling. Just tired, and like, go sit in the car.
Yeah, turn the heat on, sit in the car.
Yeah, go get the weight off. We'll be right here next to you. But yeah, go sit in the car, get the weight off. It's like a sauna.
Yeah.
And there's no saunas, you know, really up in Fargo. You have to go, like, to the fitness center. Then they have specific rules, like, geez, we're not going to do all this.
Just yeah.
Go sit. Last year in Fargo, I think it was like 100 degrees. Yeah, so it's really hot. Yeah.
One of my first dates with my wife, she came to one of my fights. And I was traveling from Fort Benning because I was down there for a school. And I traveled to Bowling Green, Kentucky, to go take a fight and had a hot box it the whole way. Oh, wow. So she was like, this is not, I don't know about this. Right.
You're crazy. You're a crazy guy. So, we like being crazy sometimes.
That's right. We're shaped and molded by those experiences. You know, we remember the losses and the times we were in the, you know, hot boxing, but like, we don't remember all the great ones either sometimes. Right, exactly. So we got the, what do you see for the future for Moen Academy?
Like I said, this postseason was a really crazy postseason. And, you know, I traveled to Spokane, Washington, traveled to Vegas, Northern Plains in Wisconsin, you know, then duels. Mm-hmm. I was a coach for duels this year. That was out in Philly. But in between there too, I was you know, going to a weekend tournaments for freestyle and Greco, reffing at tournaments, and I don't foresee that coming to an end. I think it's only going to get greater.
Yeah.
You know, my goal is to get more athletes to go and competing at these high level tournaments. You know, my goal is to produce Division I athletes. You know, my goal is if they all go D1, I want them to go to college and go compete for a national title. You know, D2, D3, NAI, JUCO, anywhere. Yeah. I want these kids to be successful in life, not only in wrestling, but in life in general. You know, there's more to life than wrestling. You know, some kids won't, you know, coach wrestling. Some say it might be done. There might go be an IT. They might go be an engineer. They might go do this or that, you know, wherever their passion is. I want them to go do that. I want to be successful. And, you know, at one time in their life, they might come back and say, Hey coach, can I help you? I'm like, heck yeah. Come share the knowledge.
Yeah. I've had two of your, athletes on our podcast. Tyler Harper and Skylar Slade, two of my favorite people to watch wrestle.
Yes.
So, tell me, you know, we're doing the documentary for Tyler. You're going to be on there. We've got shots from over at Simpson.
Awesome.
Right. Got your interview and that's all going well. How do you feel like, Tyler's matching up this year? He's going to be 106, correct?
Yes.
For the Fargo tournament.
Yep. Yep. And I talked to his dad a little bit ago as well. And we're talking about the bracket and we see kids trickling in here and trickling there, and Tyler's gonna be ready. He you know, that kid is one of the hardest workers in the room. The determination in his eyes, I feed off that.
Yeah.
And I push him and he responds to it and he works hard. He's a kid that I don't have to sit like, hey, come on, you know, let's go, get going. You mm-hmm. know, he takes the initiative right away, and it shows in his performance, his attitude, and everything else. He's very coachable. You know, I watch his matches at duels, and we have got to make a few tweaks here and there to adjust some things to be ready for these kids, because I'm sure we're going to end up wrestling one of those kids at Nationals, and they're going to go back to that same move, how they took him down, and we're going to have to make those little adjustments to not give him a takedown and turn into our offense.
Yeah. And how's Skylar looking? I haven't got to see her practice for a little bit.
Yep. Skylar's looking good. She's got back from duels. I think she had one tough loss from a girl from Minnesota. But and I was in the juniors division, and so she's wrestling U16 at Fargo, and I think her she's gonna have a really good shot. You know, she's a girl too. I don't have to you know get on her case about. She just does the work already. Hey, you know, I'll look over and she, you know, she's going to work. I don't have to babysit. You know, and that's it. And that's one thing. You know, I tell you know my kids, I should not have to babysit you.
Yeah.
When you walk through that door. Attitude.
Well, that's that college preparation mindset too, because there's no babysitting in college.
Right, exactly. You know, I don't know any college coach that's gonna sit there and hold your hand and make sure you get up and go to class.
Yeah.
Or do your homework or whatever. Mm-hmm. There's plenty of other kids out there who can do the exact same thing that you're doing and can be coachable and go do the same thing.
Right. Right. And how do you feel about what's going on in the women's wrestling? So that's you know, the first year it's sanctioned. You got Skylar winning her first state title as a freshman. You know, how do you feel the future for women's wrestling, and are you seeking and drawing more female athletes into Moen?
Yes. I think it's a great opportunity for women in wrestling. You know, like I'm hoping one of my girls wrestle, you know, by time they get to that high level, you know, it's going to be an awesome opportunity for just more opportunities to compete and seek out, you know, college, opportunities to wrestle in college.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I love to have more girls in the room. You know, I think it's going to be a great thing here in the future.
And what can you tell, those that are listening, what throughout your experiences and your life lessons that you've learned, how do you the kids that are kind of like they're winning, they're doing good, but they haven't like peaked and got over that thing because of maybe a block in their mindset, like you were talking about, you had that mental block, you know, through your experience and time with that, what would you suggest them to do to start building confidence in their mindset?
Believe in yourself right away. If it ain't gonna happen right now, keep doing what you're doing. Be positive. Keep working hard. Your time's gonna come. You know, there's plenty of kids who I've seen throughout all age levels perform at different stages in their life. You know, I had a college teammate who placed eighth in 1A in Iowa, then ends up being a NAI national champ his sophomore year.
Yeah.
You know, every kid shines at different stages in your life. It ain't going to happen now. It's going to come later. Just keep, trust the process. Keep working hard. Get out of your comfort zone. Get out of your comfort zone. You know, if you don't get out, you don't try new things. You don't push yourself. You don't wake up in the morning and go for that run. You don't wake up and go do that morning lift, or you're not lifting on your off days or whatever. You're not doing enough to get better. You're staying stagnant. You're holding yourself back.
Yeah.
If you really want to be that guy and go win, you have to get out of your comfort zone. You have to go work. You got to put time in. Just like me and you know, and people that do their day job, they go to work every day. There's a reason why they get promoted. There's a reason why they get raises.
Yeah.
Because they do the same thing every day, and they go there with a positive attitude, and they get better. They get quicker at their job. They get faster. They're doing more. They're doing more jobs per day than what you're doing, what they're doing back when I first started.
I got you.
So you got to put the work in. You know, you want to have the best single leg, get in the work, get in the room, and go drill it. You want to be the best person at front head, go do it. You just got to go do it.
Yeah.
And get into practice.
We can't have that privileged mindset to be like, it's just going to come to us.
No.
You know, you're going to have to put the work in and go through the time, go through the routines. Yeah. So you mentioned the word getting out of your comfort zone. Have you ever cross trained in any other combat art like jiu-jitsu or boxing or mixed martial arts?
Yeah. So I used to roll around at, oh, sorry, I got a burp.
That's right.
Coach Purcelli's gym. You know,
cool.
Roll around with, you know, Josh Neer, Jeremy Stevens, all those guys that are going there, you know, at his location on the east side, you know. I was rolling around with those guys. And
The mat sections, the sections of mats are all different colors.
Yes, yes.
I love it.
You know, always out wrestling.
There's dogs in that room, though.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, some tough people that came out of the room. And I always roll around with them wrestling. You know, did a little bit of jiu-jitsu with them. It was a good time. It was fun. Yeah, so I did a little bit of boxing. Wasn't my forte. But I boxed with them too as well and did a little bit of kickboxing. It was fun.
It opens perspective up a little bit.
Yes, it did.
The reason I'm asking, we're starting to see, I mean, not that maybe we get more, we have the internet, so we see things develop a lot faster, but we have, you know, we're seeing like Bo Nickel, he's competing this weekend in the UFC, and then we had RBY that just competed in a grappling match.
Yep.
So, and we've had several conversations about NIL and just like how, you know, college wrestling athletes put, you know, from time when they're kids, they put so much time into that. We've talked about this time block of so much time, but there's no like reward other than, you know, your own success and the feeling and gratitude of that. But, you know, it kind of cuts off at college and you're not getting paid anymore. So right. It's kind of like moving people into this direction. Right. So, what are your thoughts about that?
I don't think it's good. You know, there's other opportunities, you know, some kids, like I said, you know, some kids don't go into a field right away. They want to keep competing, and it's a great opportunity to, you know, to go compete and get paid for it. You know, I know a wrestler, Michael Pixley, you know, mm-hmm. He's a national champ for Grandview, then a national champ for McKendree, and he just became a world champ in GI. I think it's what it is, GI.
Yeah, yeah.
And he's traveling the world, and I believe he's getting paid to do it, and he's a rock star at it. You know, like Bravo, you know, he's doing mm-hmm. won that tough match, and you got Bo Nickel come up with a really tough match. You know, I'm sure that's gonna be a decent payout. Mm-hmm. It's a great opportunity. You know, I wish I would have maybe stuck with it, but I was tired of cutting weight.
Yeah, that's always the, especially as you get older, it gets a little bit more harder to get the weight down and keep it down,
right,
and stay competitive. So You gonna watch the fights this weekend?
I may. I had a wrestling parent call me the other day. Hey, you want to go watch this fight? I'm like, well, maybe.
That'd be interesting. I like that he's, you know, represents pure wrestling. You know, and obviously they built a facility up there now that he can train in full time. But I'd like to see that there's something that they can do that's rewarding that's afterwards. And it's interesting about mixed martial arts, because we had like the Randy Couture's, and we had those guys that were Dan Severn, all these guys that were early, and Matt Hughes in the game of that. And it's like there's evolutions and revolutions of it, right? You get like the wrestlers that came in and shut down.
Yes.
You know, the almost shut down jiu-jitsu, right? Because mm-hmm. they can stay on top and punch, right? Yep. And then they, people got really good at takedowns.
Yep.
So then it forced the wrestlers to become strikers, right, and now you're seeing strikers that are wrestlers. So it's interesting how we visualize wrestling now. Wrestling has evolved from when I was a wrestler a lot. There's a lot more scrambling situations that look familiar to other athletic events.
Right. And, you know, but talking about, you know, jiu-jitsu and wrestling and all that, I remember George St. Pierre, you know, when he first joined the UFC, he got beat up by Matt Hughes right away. Then you hear him hiring a Olympic wrestler from Canada to be his training partner in wrestling. Mm-hmm. And as soon as he, you know, I seen tremendous gains in his wrestling ability as soon as he started working out that guy, and he's ended up being one of the best UFC fighters in the game.
Yeah, yeah. So there's another opportunity for wrestlers too, is like find mixed martial arts gyms and become that main wrestling coach in there too.
Yep, yeah, exactly.
Awesome. Any shout outs you want to give out there before we close up out of here?
Shout out to my family, you know, my wife, Morgan, being my one biggest supporters, my daughters, you know, having, you know, being there for me as well. Love them to death. My family being supportive, all the coaches in my, you know, that have been with me. Thank you all. Wrestling parents as well. Thank you all for being there, supporting as well. Getting your kids to practice. Love it. Everyone, just thank you so much. It's been amazing. The ride has been amazing, and I want to continue this ride and help everybody the best I can and get you where they need to be.
Heck yeah. And when are you taking off for Fargo?
I leave next Friday morning.
Excellent. And then I don't know if we got the numbers on it, but you have quite a few athletes that are competing, right? And yes. both freestyle and Greco.
Yes, correct. Yep. So
anybody we should be like keeping our eyes out on?
Yeah. You know, every kid that you can, returning all Americans, you know, you have Harper, Cooper Martinson, Max Riggins, Connor Fizer, Tyler Harper, Kane Tigas has making some noise as well from Riverdale. Some other contenders on the Fargo list too. You know, you have Mike Slade, Skylar Slade, Bella Percelli, Randy Nichols. They all have a shot. Like I said, it's they come down to, are they right here ready? Conditioned. They're all conditioned well. They're all wrestling well. It's gonna be interesting. It's gonna be a fun time. I'm excited, and I hope I get coach my first national champ at Fargo.
And I seen Mike Slade signed, right?
Yes. We got our first Division I commitment, Mike Slade, at Campbell University. That was huge. I'm excited for that kid. He's worked off his tail day in, day out. I've been working with that kid since 2016, and he's gonna do great things in college.
Yeah, and I'd love to have Mike on the show maybe after Fargo.
Yeah,
have him come on and share his experience.
Definitely, he would probably love to do that.
Yeah,
as well.
Maybe we can sit you over in the corner and we can do a three way here.
Heck yeah.
We haven't done that on the podcast yet, so it might be fun.
Perfect, I'd love to do that. And it's going to be pretty interesting. So, yeah, keep your eyes on those guys if you can. Be on Flow Wrestling. If you have a membership, you can get your notification set up for those guys. And, Ryan, you got a couple other kids in the mix too. Ryan Ryder can have a shot at 20, being All-American. He's going to do really well, I believe. Lennon Fexaphone, Foxall National Champ, third place.
Yeah, that kid's tough.
He could be in the mix as well at Fargo, be a contender. All the kids that are going for Moen, they all have a shot to be a contender, to be an All-American. It's come down to are we ready up here and believing that we can do it. So yeah. They can all do it. I'm waiting for the first one to get a stop sign or a Fargo plaque.
Yeah, there you go.
So I know they can do it. It's just we got to go out there and outfight our opponent.
Yeah. Well, I wish you the best of luck, you and your coaching staff, all the Iowa athletes competing, the Moen athletes that are representing your academy and the academy and your family in the future. I wish you all the best of luck and God bless you. Thanks for coming on the show, TJ. Yep. Appreciate you.
Have a good one.